So in the shape analysis lecture, we basically saw that at least from the theoretical point of view, sometimes it's inconvenient to work on incomplete spaces. So there we had this exceptional point which was taken out, but in a certain sense, this incompleteness problem is a little bit artificial because, I mean, whenever you have some complete manifold or something, you can always drill a hole and make it incomplete. So this is actually not too surprising that one gets a problem with, let's say, completeness here. And what we want to do in this chapter, we want to study, well, let's say different notions of completeness you can have on a weak Riemannian manifold. And then we'll discuss a little bit the failure of the famous Hopf-Reno theorem in infinite dimensions. So, but let's start with this. And let me first give you the definitions of what do you mean, what can you mean by completeness of a Riemannian manifold. So actually, I mean, there are several notions of completeness. So the setting will always be we have a weak Riemannian manifold. And then M can have several completeness properties. So we say M is metrically complete. If the geodesic distance turns M into a complete metric space, in the sense that Cauchy sequences with a turn with respect to the geodesic distance converge. So, I mean, this entails obviously two things. On one hand, you have the completeness, and then on the other hand, you are requiring that the geodesic distance really is a distance in the sense we have. So, you don't want something like vanishing a geodesic distance or something like that. Okay, and so we can also say M is geodesically complete. If every geodesic can be continued for all time. Right, so I mean, the geodesics we've saw are solutions to second order di ordinary differential equations, and well, even in the usual regime, we have local existence and uniqueness for these things, so they will exist for some short time at least. And if we can continue these curves indefinitely, then we say it's geodesically complete. And the final property is not so much a completeness property, but it's very much related. And we say that M has minimizing geodesics. If for every, let's say, A and B in M in the same connected component, there exists a length minimizing geodesic connecting A and B. So in other words, there exists C, a geodesic from A to B with the property that the length of the geodesic is the same as the geodesic distance of A and B. Okay, and so we have these three properties: metrically complete, geodesically complete, and has minimizing geodesics. And now let me recall, so in, or perhaps introduce you to, if you haven't seen it before, the following theorem, which is true in finite dimensions. And this is the famous Hopf-Reno theorem. Which states the following. So if we have a Riemannian, a finite dimensional, so finite dimensional Riemannian manifold, then M is metrically complete. If and only if M is geodesically complete. Moreover, if M is metrically complete, it has minimizing geodesics. Okay, so we see that at least in finite dimensions, metrically complete is equivalent to geodesically complete, and this and well, both of these properties imply that we have minimizing geodesics. However, I'm not going to do the proof of this one. We are actually just proving a part of this theorem, which also holds for strong Riemannian metrics. We're getting to that soon. But if you're looking in the classical into the classical proof of this theorem, then what you'll see is that at some crucial point in the proof, compactness arguments are used. So the proof of the Hopf-Reno theorem really depends on, let's say, the manifold being locally compact. If you do not have local compactness, then well, as we shall see, this Hopf-Reno theorem fails. And this is really one of the big things which already happens for a strong Riemannian manifold, which is infinite dimensional. So in general, you do not have, or you cannot assume that the Hopf-Reno theorem is true. However, we shall prove now. That for a strong Riemannian manifold, the implication metrically complete implies geodesically complete. Remains true. The converse is what needs the compactness argument. Again, in the proof, I will cheat a little bit because this proof actually needs a little bit more insight from Riemannian geometry. But since the rest of the proof is a very classical how do you prolong solutions of differential equations argument, I just wanted to show you this. Okay, so let me briefly sketch the proof. Okay, so let us assume Cx from an interval j with values in M is a geodesic. Geodesic with derivative at zero being equal to this x, that's what the subscript means, and this is based at some point tp, at some point p. So the argument is always the same. So we want to see, a priori, we only know that the j is a small interval which contains zero. And we want to argue by contradiction. And assume that the supremum of J, this is what we define as T plus, so the end time of the existence interval is smaller than infinity. Okay. We can reparametrize Cx such that if I'm computing the length of Cx restricted to an interval from, let's say, R to S, I get just the distance from R to S. So this is always possible for all R, S in J. If you haven't seen how this works, we have a small exercise. So basically there's just one possible way to reparameterize them so that it stays a geodesic, so that the geodesic equation is still satisfied. And however, when you compute the length and so the length of the geodesic will always be a constant times the length of the interval, and you can reparametrize in a way that the constant is one. So, and that's well known in finite dimensions, also works in infinite dimensions. Okay, so this is an exercise that this is possible if you haven't seen it. Okay, now we pick a Cauchy sequence. Tn with the property that Tn approaches from below the our end time, and now as so now the it will become apparent why we want to reparametrize. So sorry, not length, distance it should be. So the distance, I don't know, how do I need to set? So the distance of these two things, Tn, Cx, Tm. So note, we know a curve which has, which bounds the geodesic distance from above. So this is length of Cx in restricted to the interval Tn, Tm. Because we have reparametrized, we know that this is equal to the distance between Tn and Tm. And now, since on the right-hand side, this is, or this, these are elements of a Cauchy sequence, this implies that Cx, Tn, n forms a Cauchy sequence in space M with the geodesic distance, right? And this is where we can use our assumption on the space. We know that it's that the space is symmetrically complete. So that means every Cauchy sequence with respect to the geodesic distance converges. Okay, so as M is symmetrically complete, we know that there exists a limit of these guys Cx, Tn for n going to infinity, and this is a point, let's call it Q. And now I need to cheat a little bit and use some more knowledge from Riemannian geometry. So pick an epsilon larger than zero, but so small that if I take the metric ball with respect to the geodesic distance of radius epsilon of Q is the domain of Riemannian normal coordinates. And this is something we haven't explained in the lecture, so if you haven't seen it, there is something called the Riemannian exponential map, and it restricts to a a diffeomorphism from, let's say, the tangents from an open subset of the tangent space at Q. So you have this open subset to a ball which is sufficiently small. And these are the Riemannian normal coordinates. And so the point here is that what this Riemannian, so this is the restriction of the Riemannian exponential map. And it's a little bit similar. So just in concept, not in what it actually does, but for a Lie group, we have seen the exponential map, and what the exponential map is doing, it's basically taking a tangent vector and it's following the one parameter subgroup. And what the Riemannian exponential map does, it takes a tangent vector and computes the geodesic and follows the geodesic with respect to this tangent data up to time one. So why do we need this these Riemannian normal coordinates? If we have them, we have actually some information about geodesics which run around in this distance ball. So actually what you can prove, so for we take the final time and why do I say t naught? Okay, and some time t naught, which is smaller than epsilon half, there is a geodesic. Let's say call it gamma, with the following properties. If I take the derivative of gamma at zero, I get the same derivative as the original geodesic. Should next be in the at the at time t naught, and by uniqueness of geodesics, we have gamma of t is equal to c x t plus t naught. Right. So what do I mean by uniqueness of geodesics? The geodesic solves a second order ordinary differential equation. We are in a strong Riemannian setting, so that means we are on a Hilbert manifold, and there we have the usual existence and uniqueness theorem, and we have now two curves which satisfy the same differential equation, namely gamma and c of t plus t naught, and so they need to coincide wherever they are defined. Okay. However, so we have. I mean, what do we gain from shifting basically the CX here? So since gamma is contained in the normal coordinates, around our point Q. The domain of definition of gamma contains at least this interval minus epsilon half is epsilon half. Okay, and this shows that we can extend CX beyond T plus. And the reason for this is, of course, you see where we have chosen the T naught closer to the T plus than epsilon half. And now we see that if we shift the time index, We see that the heuristic curve exists at least up to time epsilon half, and as always, the solutions of differential equations exist in open sets, so we can nudge it a slight little bit beyond the t plus, and this is a contradiction to our assumption that the t plus was smaller than infinity. Right, so we can extend it a little bit, and we can basically continue this whenever t plus is finite. We can go a little bit further, and this concludes the proof. So here we have, I mean, this is what still works also, let's say, at least on a strong Riemannian manifold. On a weak Riemannian manifold, the problem is that you might lack, again, normal coordinates or well-behaved exponential map. So we're making no claims here. So this is just for a strong Riemannian manifold. Still, this implication metrically complete implies geodesically complete remains true because we are not using any sort of compactness arguments. Okay. And so due to the lack of local compactness, the converse fails in general. And let me show you a very famous example where this goes wrong. I think this is also historically one of the first examples which showed up here. So the following example. I mean, on one hand, it's very beautiful because it's a very easy, strong Riemannian manifold we get here, where the converse is false, and it's a very geometric example in that, in principle, I mean, if it wasn't infinite dimension, you could even try to, I mean, one can try to make some pictures of it, despite this thing being infinite dimensional. And the name of the example is Grossmann's ellipsoid. Okay, and this is now a very hands-on example. So we consider the Hilbert space of L2 sequences, again with orthonormal bases En, again with the underscore, to signify a vector. So I'm not writing that out because we did it several lectures before, right? So the En is again the sequence which has a one in the nth place and zeros everywhere else. And we have the usual inner product where we multiply the two sequences component wise and then sum up. And okay, define now following. So we define A1 as 1 and An as 1 plus 2 to the minus n for n greater or equal than 2. Consider the ellipsoid. And this is Grossmann's ellipsoid. E. And we define this ellipsoid as all the sequences xn, en, n. This should be lying inside of L2. So what I basically want to be doing, I mean, this is just, if you want, a complicated way of writing down an element in L2. But the reason why I want to be doing that is, we want that xn squared divided by an squared is equal to 1. And now it becomes clear why this is an ellipsoid. So if you're remembering finite dimensional geometry, then if all the an were 1, then we would just have an equation for the L2 sphere, or in finite dimensions, you would get just the finite dimension sphere in Euclidean space. But when you pick an array of positive numbers and divide by them, or by their square actually here, then you get then the equation describes an ellipsoid, right? So this is something which is apparent in finite dimension geometry, and this is just the infinite dimensional version. Okay, let us now let's now check several things. Okay, first item is E submanifold of H. I mean, so we actually, what we want to be doing, we want to turn E into a strong Riemannian manifold, and we want to study its properties. And on this ellipsoid, it will turn out that the converse statement of the Hopf-Reno theorem, namely that geodesically complete implies metric decomplete, is wrong on Grossmann's ellipsoid. Okay, so is this a submanifold? And for this, we consider the smooth diffeomorphism F from H to H, and what it does, it just sends a sequence xn to an times xn. Do I want to have an times xn? Sorry. No, I want to divide, I guess. Yes. Xn divide an this n in n. Okay, why do I want to divide? Then what we see is Grossmann's ellipsoid is just the image under this mapping F of the Hilbert sphere, right? Okay, so this is nice now, because we know already that the Hilbert sphere is a splitting submanifold of the Hilbert space H, and so it's an exercise. We actually used this once before. If F is a diffeomorphism then the image of a submanifold, or a splitting sub, actually I think we're just doing it for splitting submanifolds, but stays true also for other submanifolds, of a splitting submanifold is a splitting submanifold. So with this trick, what we see here is that that the ellipsoid needs to be a splitting submanifold. Okay, we turn E into a strong Riemannian manifold by endowing it with the pullback metric. Induced by the inclusion, right? So yesterday we saw that there's as soon as we have an immersion, and the inclusion is an immersion, or actually it's an embedding here, an inclusion. So E is included in H, and this gives us a pullback metric on the Grossmann's ellipsoid. So this is now really a Riemannian, or a strong Riemannian manifold. Again, we have seen already, just as a side remark, we have seen already that We know that the Hilbert sphere is also a strong Riemannian submanifold. With respect to the pullback metric. Induced by the inclusion of the sphere. Okay, and now let me draw a picture because so the Hilbert sphere has a very nice property. If you ask what is the geodesic on a Hilbert sphere, so let me just draw again the two-dimensional sphere embedded in R3. And so we have seen this picture several times now. So how do I get a geodesic, let's say, from the North Pole to some other point P here? So this is what is usually called a great circle. So you're basically following this great circle around here. Okay, and if I could draw better, then this would also look nice. So this is a great circle. You can prove that, well, okay, now this is a picture for the finite dimensional sphere, that this is geodesic connecting N and P. And now for the infinite dimensional, sphere, SH, also the great circles are the geodesics. And now you might wonder, okay, well, this infinite, I mean, what do we mean by great circle here now? This is infinite dimension. I cannot draw such a nice picture or something. But in fact, I mean, the fact here is, let me draw a wrong picture because, well, this is obviously not infinite dimension, but let's make a picture of the Hilbert sphere. And now I pick, so Hilbert sphere in L2. And now I pick a point here. Let's perhaps not take the North Pole. Let's say this is the point P. I want to connect it with the point Q. And I mean, the way how you play this back to a finite dimensional problem, which you can understand, is basically, we have lots of finite dimensional spaces sitting here by just restricting the directions in which we can go. So for example, I can pick a third point here. Okay, I mean, this doesn't look really right. So point R, which is just an auxiliary point, which I pick just to make sure that I haven't accidentally picked P and Q that lie on the same line. And so what I'm doing, I'm basically choosing a plane, so a two-dimensional subspace, which intersects the... which intersects the infinite dimensional sphere, and basically this allows me to look at all the paths in this two-dimensional subspace, or depending on how I chose, perhaps it's also it's even a higher dimensional subspace. Perhaps it's probably if I pick three points, I will usually, if not in the degenerate case, get a three-dimensional subspace. So, and what you can exploit now is basically that the projections onto these subspaces are length decreasing, and what this basically shows, if you have a nice short connection in your subspace, I mean, this might not be the shortest connection you can get on the Hilbert sphere, because because you might have chosen a bad subspace, so to speak. But this allows you to, in essence, study a finite dimensional problem. And what turns out if you're doing this and you're analyzing this situation, I mean, and full details can be found in Klingenberg's book, 95, Riemannian Geometry. And this is 1, 10, 13, item 3, where this is proved is that actually also for the infinite dimensional Hilbert sphere, the great circles form the geodesic. So the nice thing about, okay, this was now a little excursion to the Hilbert sphere. The point here is that on the Hilbert sphere, the geodesics are completely explicit, and we will use this to show that something is going badly wrong on Grossmann's ellipsoid. For this, we have to know that what the geodesics are, and the upshot, because we have these geodesics, this shows, in addition, that the Hilbert sphere is geodesically complete. I should have said the stronger one. Actually, it's metrically complete. Then, because of our former statement, we also have the geodesic completeness for the Hilbert sphere. Okay, and now we have, moreover, so a new point. We see that F of RE1. So note that E1, this is 1, 0. This is an element in the Hilbert sphere. And okay, I mean, if I multiply it with some number r, then it's not no longer in the Hilbert sphere. I just wanted to get at that this is r times E1 for all r in the reals. And so let us assume that gamma is path in the Hilbert sphere, connecting E1 to minus E1, which is also in the Hilbert sphere, right? Then F composed with gamma is a path connecting E1 and minus E1. So this was actually where we use this condition here. Right. So this is, you should read this as F of E1 and F of minus E1, connecting E1 and E minus E1 in Grossmann's ellipsoid in E. Since F is a diffeomorphism, every path connecting E1 and minus E1 in E arises in this way. Okay. Now, where did I? Ah, oh, now I see. Indeed, I tricked myself. So this diffeomorphism here should actually be what I wrote down. So it should be an times this one because of y. Why is that? I mean, the condition here is we are dividing by an squared, right? And so the sorry about that. Now it's correct. So an times xn, this actually transforms the Hilbert sphere into the ellipsoid, not the one where I divided, because this is the condition we want. And the xn square, if the xn come from the Hilbert sphere, they actually sum up to one, right? Okay, sorry, I was confused. Now the rest of my notes make more sense. Okay. So every path in E connecting these two things arises in the way. Okay, and let me so as a special case, of exercise 4.7.3, the following is true. So we have the length of the original path gamma on the Hilbert sphere. Well, okay, I mean, what is it? We can just compute it using the Riemannian metric, and we know what the Riemannian metric is because it's induced by the inner product. So it's just this guy here. So we have the derivatives of the components of 2 time t squared dt. And so we have that this is smaller or equal than the same sum a n squared gamma n squared of t. I mean, this is apparent because all of the a n are larger or equal than zero. Sorry, larger or equal than one. That's the point. Yeah, so we are making it bigger. And here, what is this? This is, of course, just the length of f applied to gamma. Okay. Right. So, okay, let's see. So we see that there a lower bound for the length of the of path. Lower bound for length of path connecting E1 and minus E1 in Grossmann's ellipsoid is the length of path connecting these points in the Riemann sphere. Okay. So can we actually compute the distance of E1 and E2 with respect to the Hilbert sphere? Well, indeed we can, because we already know from the point before, so up here, we know that the we know that the distance between E1 and E2, or that the geodesic between E1 and E2 is given by a great circle. And how do you describe a great circle in this setting? Well, we can actually show that this is the length of the curve cosine pi t times E1 plus sine pi t E2. This is one of the great circles. And this is an exercise show that this is a geodesic for d from 0 to 1. Right, I mean, it's just like what you expect on a sphere. It's basically just the great circle formulation. And if we are just calculating what we get here, we see that the length of this geodesic is pi. Right, so the distance here is on the great circle is pi. So we see that every single because we have this calculation here. So we know that the geodesic distance is pi, and we get as a lower bound for everything on the Grossmann's ellipsoid that these two points need to be at least that the geodesic distance on Grossmann's ellipsoid is at least pi. Okay. Right. So let's analyze the situation a little bit further. So what our goal is, the goal is as follows. We want to show that the distance with respect to Grossmann's ellipsoid of these two points E1 and minus E1 is pi. First thing. Second thing. There is no geodesic on there's no geodesic on Grossmann's ellipsoid realizing this distance. Now I remember that I was telling you something wrong. So Grossmann's ellipsoid is not the example that the converse in the Hopfrino theorem is false, where I said that from geodesically complete does not imply metrically complete. Actually, what I wanted so Grossmann's ellipsoid was the example that geodesically and metrically complete do not imply that there exist minimizing geodesics. So I apologize for that. Actually, I was thinking when I was in the beginning, there are examples by Atkins where you have also the other implications are wrong. So, but they are more involved. So here we are actually only doing that there's no length minimizing geodesic between E1 and E2, E1 and minus E1. Okay, sorry for that. Right. Okay, let us first note by definition of F, we have that the length of a path gamma is equal to the length of the transformed path if and only if the derivatives of gamma, of the components gamma n, are zero for all n greater or equal than 2. Okay. However, the only curve starting at E1 satisfying this is the constant curve. Staying in E1. Right? So why is that? I mean, you basically, we have this condition that everything should sum up to 1. We are starting at a point where everything is in E1, and we are not allowed, because of this condition on the differentials, to move in any other direction than the direction of E1. So the only way we could be moving is in the one-dimensional subspace generated by E1. But the one-dimensional subspace intersects the Hilbert sphere exactly at two points, namely at E1 and minus E1. So There's no simply no way to satisfy this. So what this implies, we have for all curves joining E1 and minus E1 in the ellipsoid, the strict inequality. So we know that the length of F composed with gamma needs to be strictly larger than pi. Okay. And right. So this actually shows that if this is really true, so if the distance up here really is pi, then we cannot have any curve realizing this distance, so there cannot be any minimal geodesics. Okay, and how do we see this? I mean, we still need to see that the distance actually is pi. It might be strictly larger than pi, but okay, let's okay, so to complete the example, we need to see that the distance on E of these two things, E1 and E2, minus E1, is actually pi, because then there is no minimizing geodesic from E1 to E minus E1, even though the Grossmann's ellipsoid is complete, as the image of a metrically complete submanifold. Okay, and right, so let's see how this goes. Well, we consider the half ellipses gamma n joining E1 and the antipodal point minus E1 in the E1 EN plane, right? And so now we're taking exactly these plane intersections I was talking about. E1 and E2 EN do not lie in the same plane, so we really get a two-dimensional subspace, and we can compute basically what is this half ellipsis. So where did we have our half circle, right? So we have this formula here on the Hilbert sphere. If we are piping that through our diffeomorphism F, we would get the half ellipses in this case in the E1 E2 plane, right? And I mean, now the calculation, I mean, how do you get the half ellipses in the E1 EN plane? Well, you just replace E2 here with EN and then put it into your mapping F. And okay, so right, so how do we do this? The E1 EN plane, so we have length of gamma n. So this is the same as the length of f of cosine pi t E1 plus sine pi t en. And now what we get from our diffeomorphism, so this is this is the length of the following curve. So cosine pi t stays with e1 plus, and now we have to multiply here with an sine pi t en. Okay, and well, looking at this, so when we're taking here the derivative and then the norm, so we see that this is smaller or equal than 1 plus 2 to the minus n. Right, this was, remember that this is just the an, so going right back to the beginning, where is this coming from? Here, an is 1 plus 2 to the minus n. Oops, okay. So multiply it with pi. And we see that this converges to pi as n goes to infinity. Right, so as always with these examples, so we have seen several L2 examples where the crucial part was that we can always, we have infinitely many dimensions where we can sort of send a parameter towards infinity. I mean, that was on one hand the example with the vanishing geodesic distance, that we needed to go in one direction infinitely far, and we need to take a limit there. And here it's exactly the same, as the longer the plane one of the generating vectors for the plane is out. So because we are Grossmann's ellipsoid is basically pressing it down with this element in the series of of the sequence of the an. So the an basically press this down, and we are not seeing as much of the path as if we are in one of the first in the first directions. So here we see that this converges to pi, and this is a path connecting e1 and minus e1 in the ellipsoid. Therefore, the distance in the ellipsoid of e1 and minus e1 is pi. Okay, so and this completes the discussion of Grossmann's ellipsoid. So there we have a very concrete infinite dimensional manifold which is metrically and geodesically complete, but which nevertheless has no minimizing geodesics between these two points e1 and minus e1. Okay, thus the Hopf-Reno theorem fails in infinite dimensions. Okay, and so we've actually seen that metrically and geodesically complete does not necessarily imply existence of minimizing geodesics. And there are more examples to the rest of the implication which could exist between these notions. So we can prove that geodesically complete does not imply metrically complete in infinite dimensions, and also a sort of, for example, geodesic complete and minimizing geodesics does not imply metrically complete. And all of these other implications we might have between these two things, those are all Examples are more involved, so we are not discussing them here. The other failures of relations are more involved. And but recorded in the work of Atkins. So, and for an exact citation of this, I refer to the lecture notes, where you can find sort of the papers, and can find out what the how you can construct such a thing, where the other implications fail. Okay, so the upshot here is that this famous Hopf-Reno theorem is wrong, and this is frequently a huge problem, because having a Hopf-Reno theorem at your disposal is quite convenient. Let's put it like this. So this Hopf-Reno theorem, you would like to invoke it, not only in situations where you basically are searching for minimizing geodesics. So there's this whole realm of metric geometry where you would like to understand the distance function, and you would like to really be able to at least assure that these minimizing geodesics exist. This year, this actually happened when we were trying to study some interesting problem arising in the theory of rough path, and sort of the on a first approach, somebody who was very knowledgeable in Riemannian and sub-Riemannian geometry prepared sort of a proof for our preprint, and was citing the Hopf-Reno theorem, and then basically we're done. And unfortunately, as we've just seen, the Hopf-Reno theorem is not true in infinite dimensions. And this created a lot of problems, and basically, to circumvent all these problems which arise, which arose at least in this point, due to the failure of the Hopf-Reno theorem, we had basically to work a few more months with a new idea to compensate for this. So it's very annoying that the Hopf-Reno theorem fails in infinite dimensions. Okay, and then this is one of the instances. I mean, we said yesterday that the world of strong Riemannian manifolds is almost like the world of finite dimensional Riemannian manifolds. However, one of the dividing pieces is that this Hopf-Reno theorem from finite dimensions does not carry over to the infinite dimensional setting.